everyone is there. Welcome to the afternoon sessions. We'll have two talks, and the first talk is given by Irina Kogan. I hope I'm not mispronouncing your name. So, have 15 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me here, and thank you for NSF Grant for supporting my travel here, Conference Grant. And I will talk about this generalization of integrability theorem of Darboux and the stable configuration condition. And this is a joint work with Michael Benfield, who was a student at NC State. He was my student. He graduated in 2016, and he decided, to my regret, to quit academic mathematics, and he is now working in California on data science, and he's quite happy with that. Also, he was a very strong student. Some of the key ideas of this work belongs to him, and so I think it's a loss of mathematics, but maybe called mathematics, but maybe again for data science, I don't know. And the next collaborator is Chris Jensen. He's my long-term collaborator from Pennsylvania State University. We wrote several papers together. And I think in 2017, there was a DART conference in Linz, Austria, where I actually gave a talk which had a little bit shorter title. It just had a title, Generalization of an Integrability Theorem of Darboux. And at that time, we were finishing this paper, almost about to submit, and I was traveling to this conference and preparing the talk, and about 4 days before, we realized there is a gap in the proof. And you know this sinking feeling. Something is wrong. Something is not working. So I remember on the plane, I'm trying to fix it. There should be a fix. I could not fix it. Apparently, we realized that there is no fix to it. We are missing a necessary condition, which is this stable configuration condition. And of course, this was a very terrible feeling then. But this instead came up to be two papers. One, we introduced the stable configuration conditions, finished the proof, and it is published in Journal of Geometric Analysis. And then we wrote another paper in a slightly more specific situation. We, for equations of this type, hyperbolic equations UXY, which is written out there, we really studied this stable configuration condition and also found that it is quite interesting. And the research part was supported by now expired grants by NSF. All right, so I'm going to talk about the integrability theorem for PDE. And what do I mean? And this is a geometric integrability theorems. And they are theorems about existence and also the size of the solution set of an overdetermined system of PDE. And what do we mean by the size? We mean by the number of arbitrary functions and constant the general solution depends on. But we also would like to a little bit address a more subtle question, is about what type of data can be prescribed to guarantee the uniqueness of the solution. So somehow these arbitrary constants and functions in the solution, they tell you what type of data you can prescribe, or at least say in some sense reflect this, to get the unique solution. And I will give a very simple example to indicate that these are related but a little bit different questions. The degree of freedom in the solution and the data you can prescribe. And I will do a very simple equation. This is second order of DE. You take second derivative of u with respect to x, and you want it to be equal to negative u, right? This is second order of DE. We know that solution depends on two constants. Of course, we can write it very explicitly. It's a combination of cosine and sine. I have a paper about it. This is two solutions, right? Two constants in the solution. And now I can prescribe some initial data. And we know very well, so if I say that I'm prescribing something just to notation A and derivative at x0 to B, right? At the same point, this would be a unique solution. This is a initial value problems. Then I can solve all the solve for C1, C2, so it's initial value problem. However, if I start to prescribe boundary values, it also would be two sort of constraints, but I might or might not get a solution. For instance, if I do like this, so if I prescribe u of x0 equal to a, and u of x1 equal to b, I also prescribe sort of similar looking thing. Well, it depends what I have prescribed. Situation could be very different. So I could have, say, I prescribed u of 0 to be 0 and u of pi equal to 1, and I would have no solutions. Or I could have prescribed, say, u of 0 equal to 0 and u of pi over 2 equal to 1, and I would have unique solution. And on the other hand, I could have prescribed something u of 0 is equal to 0 and u of pi equal to 0, and I will have just infinitely many solutions. U is equal to c1 sine of x, so like one parametric family of the solution. Right? So these are very much related questions of degree of freedom of prescribing, like degree of freedom in the general solution, number of constants, but they are by no means equivalent.
What if you choose x0 and x1? Random in some sense.
I've not thought about that. I think, what is it generic? I think you have to be, I would say there would be no solution. I just think for 1 minute. It's a good question. I think every one of us, if you become bored with my talks, that's a question you definitely cannot see in 5 minutes. Yeah, I have not thought about this. But that's a very natural question. So we talked about that. So now I would like to talk to you about examples of integrability theorems of PDE. So there is a very powerful theorem called Cartan-Keller theorem. It was originally designed, so it is very well, it has an algorithm to tell you how many what is the size of the solution set, Cartan-Keller theorem. It would exactly determine for you how many arbitrary function, constants, or what's not, you can have in a generic solution, or maybe there is, if there is a solution, because we are talking about what determines systems. It requires analyticity. For a very special cases, for instance, there is a work of Dan Young, where he relaxes analyticity for C infinity, but it's a special cases, and there are very well-known examples of not analytic system where Cartan-Keller theorem doesn't work. Another sort of, I don't say problem or feature of Cartan-Keller theorem, when you can realize this arbitrary function and constants as your initial data, but you cannot sort of prescribe it beforehand. When you run Cartan-Keller algorithm, it tells you in the process where should you prescribe the data. You cannot state like general results, I can prescribe data here and there. Now, the theorem which we would like to generalize here in this work is Darboux theorem. It is quite specialized. It is much more special than this Cartan-Keller theorem, but it provides explicit prescription of data and guarantees uniqueness, which guarantees uniqueness, it requires only C1 regularity of the equation of data, C1 smoothness, so it's not analytic by any means. And this theorem, I think, is a little bit obscure in the sense when I we started to work on this and I started to talk to many people in the area about this Darboux theorem, I think I like many others Darboux theorem, this one was a little bit forgotten, not that many people kind of were aware about the theorem. So I of course will talk about this. But everyone knows this particular case of Darboux theorem, which is called Frobenius integrability theorem. This is well known, like in most of the textbooks. And this is actually a particular case of that theorem. So what I'm going to do, I would formulate and prove this generalization of the Darboux theorem. So the Darboux theorem appeared in this book more than 100 years ago. And as you see, the book is on orthogonal systems of coordinates. So what is orthogonal system of coordinates? It's not linear coordinates, so coordinates directions are not straight lines, it's not necessarily Cartesian coordinates, but what Darboux was trying to do is to describe in R3 all possible curvilinear system of coordinates, which are orthogonal to each other. Say, in R2, polar coordinates is an example. We have circles and radial lines, they're always orthogonal to each other. So that was his goal, and the theorem which he proved was the tool to achieve this goal. And if time permits, I would tell you what was our own motivation to look at this theorem, because of course we just did not, I don't know, go to the library and took an old book of Darboux. We were looking to solve another problem. And by the way, our North Carolina Mass Library has this book, so which was very lucky. And so what Darboux's PD, what did Darboux consider? He considered PDs of the following form. So you take the first derivative of your unknown function, right? And this is some prescribed functions of x and u. And what you do, so it's very simple PDEs in some sense, right? And you're allowed to pick and choose what directions you would differentiate. For instance, my first unknown function, I can differentiate in the first and second direction. And my second in five and sevens, right? And maybe my third in all seven directions, or whatever your cardinality is. So you pick and choose. And everything is C1 smooth. So this is a simple example of this system. So I have unknown u, which I only differentiate in, and this is when you have, so going back, n is a number of independent variables. And you have like n independent variables, m unknown functions, and you differentiate each function with respect to something. So this is example when both n and m is equal to 2. So I differentiate my first function u with respect to x, and v I differentiate in two directions, in both directions possible. And so my i1 in previous slide would be 1. This is index of differentiation for my first variable. And my second set would be 1 and 2. And this is c1 function. So this is an example. So what is returning to Darboux theorem? So you consider systems of this type, and you prescribe data. So how you prescribe data? You prescribe it along coordinate subspaces, where you fix for each variable. So if I want to prescribe a data for U1, I will look at all directions with respect to which I differentiated U1, fix them to a constant, and complementary subset would be where you prescribed your data. And the theorem says that under appropriate integrability conditions, which I would state later on, has unique C1 solution near x. So this is now an example with the data. So the same system. So u I differentiated with respect to x. So I'm looking to solve everything near some fixed point x bar, y bar. Okay? And so what I will do then. So if this is my point x bar, y bar, near which I want to solve everything, I know that for u, I differentiated with respect to x, so I fix x, and I will prescribe data for u here. But we, I differentiated in both directions, right? So my, I have to fix both x and y, and so I prescribe data for v only here, right? That is what I'm doing, and then I would like to kind of make a statement that I would have a unique solution. Now let's talk about integrability conditions. So integrability condition, as we know, it comes that what we want, that our equations do not contradict the quality of mixed partials, right? That is pretty much what is usual integrability conditions. So for you, I don't have any because I prescribed only one derivative, but here I prescribed both, so I need to make sure that vxy is equal to vyx. Well, I do this, I write it out, right? Just differentiating, and remember that u and v is function of x and y. But then what I want, I have like uy, vy, v with respect to y, u with respect to x, v with respect to x. I want to substitute them from the equations, right? But I'm stuck a little bit because, of course, I have like vy, but I don't have uy. Uy wasn't prescribed by the equation. And so what I need to get, I need them to require that g of u is zero to write out integrability condition. So pretty much I'm saying that not only this I have to satisfy, but I also need to be careful. This should not depend on u, right? Because otherwise I cannot write integrability condition. So this is our integrability. So now we would like to impose that g of u is equal to zero, right? And then my integrability condition I can write. So this is more or less what we want. So for this system, if I return to my example, to my initial condition, and given these two conditions, then Darboux's theorem would say if this is satisfied identically, right? Because remember, these are all functions of x, y, u, and v, right? All of these things. So if we take the now in the R2 cross R2 space, and if around this point this is satisfied as an identity, we will have a unique C1 solution. Now, of course, in general, in an example, it's a little bit easier to state once you have like arbitrary situation, you get like a lot of notation, but essentially it is what it is. The same thing, you have a general system, you prescribe initial data, and if you want to describe, so the first condition pretty much restricts some dependence here. We right away say that these functions are not allowed to depend on all possible variables. There is some restrictions here, and the second condition is equation really under, if this is true, we want mixed partial to coincide. Now, particular cases, when I alpha is 1, I recall I alpha is indices or tells us with respect to what we have to differentiate unknown u alpha, right? If for every alpha it's 1, right, we have determined system. We differentiate, we only consider derivatives of, where each unknown is differentiated only with respect to 1 variable. So there is no integrability condition, it's a determined system, and it is covered by Darboux's theorem 1. Now, if I alpha is equal to m, it means I differentiate every variable in every with respect to each coordinate. This is PDE version of Frobenius' theorem. There is also like vector field, differential form, but this was proved before Darboux, and Darboux knew the proof. He still states it in his book because he provided a new proof by induction. By the way, I did not study this question very carefully, but according to Wikipedia, Frobenius' theorem wasn't proved by Frobenius. But that you also can look up in Wikipedia and see who proved this version of Frobenius' theorem. Okay, now, so Darboux stated this theorem in general. Darboux-Sot theorem is what we are looking at. But he proved it only for n equal to 2 or n equal to 3 variables, number of variables. And for n equal 2, he uses, 1. And for n equal to 3, he identifies subsystems that can be treated by theorem 1 or by n equal to 2 case. And these subsystems are solved in right order so that the solution of one subsystem provides initial data for the next. So it's somewhat like suggests inductive proof. And then he did not go beyond n equal to 3 because recall he was looking for orthogonal coordinates in three-dimensional space. And so he writes in English translation to establish this important proposition without introducing too much notation, we restrict ourselves to systems of two or three variables, and for our applications it would be sufficient, right? So he did not go beyond n equal to 3. However, we tried, we decided, okay, this suggested the proof by induction, and we tried, and it's a lot, we succeeded, but it's a lot of notation. It became like a little bit, it became a very technical paper, so Tarpov was right. And when we wrote out this proof by induction, we also realized that this proof will not work for our generalized version. And at the same time, we realized that we can give a direct proof, not inductive proof, which would be much less technical. So we even never, it's still like preprint, but not because we did not submit it to any journal, this inductive proof, because, you know, you come up with a better proof where you would submit. Something, or at least at that time we thought that we found a better proof, then we found mistakes and we corrected mistakes, but now we have a much better proof. So our theorem generalized Darboux in two ways. So I say we are talking about generalization. First generalization is that we allow, instead of consider partial derivatives, we allow differentiation along arbitrary vector fields, right? So I will show an example. So not ddx, but some vector fields. And another, we would like to prescribe data not only along sort of affine subspaces dictated by coordinates, but maybe something more general. Maybe this green thing should be not a straight line, I differentiate with respect to x, but something line like this, or even a curve, right? The only thing we want that it doesn't have horizontal tangential direction, right? Because in this situation, recall this, we would differentiate with respect to x, so we don't want our initial data to be transversal in a complementary direction than the directions we differentiate. So this is two generalizations, so this is an example of what I mean. So this is similar to our previous example. Again, two unknown functions, one differentiated in one direction, the second in two, but see, now my directions are no longer just partial derivatives, right? This is my derivation R1. U would be a different, I will take first derivative of U with respect to X, and then plus X dDUY, right? And this is non-commuting derivation, so if you commute, computer commutator, you get this. So if you go back and rewrite it in terms of R1, R2, you get this. This guy's called structure functions, not structure constants. Here they are. And we want to have a more freedom in prescribing data. So in this situation, I would choose this manifold, this curve to prescribe the data. For V, we don't have much choices because we have to V is differentiated with respect to two directions in R2, so we can only prescribe the value at a point. So again, questions, does the solution in the neighborhood of the origin exist to unique? So here's how it would look like, right? So my purple things are integral curves of R1. My green parabolas, they're both parabolas, but one is on the side, are integral curves of R2. The blue is the initial data for U, right? And we see that it is always transversal to the purple lines. This is sort of a lines which we integrate. And for V, we have to prescribe data at a point. So, and I want to notice, how would we actually solve this system? If we would, we in practice want to solve this system, like, of course, with U and V here, it's a little bit harder, but if I erased U and V, if it would be just functions of X and Y, what would it do actually to find a solution? So I want to know what is my solution at this point, at this intersection of blue and purple. What would I do? I would read my initial data here where my purple parabola intersect blue line, right? And then I will integrate this function f along this purple line until I reach here, right? And if I want to find the value of v here, I'll start with my point here. Well, maybe that's a little bit silly because here I can just go up, right? Here and integrate h. But if I'm not, if I'm a little bit to the side, say if I need to find the value here, I will start here. I will integrate g up to here, find some value here, and then go up along green line, integrating h, right? That's what I would do. If I don't have u and v, if I have u and v, what should I do? Because if I don't have u and v, I just integrate. But now I have my unknown functions and the integrals, right? I cannot integrate, but I can do what? I can do Picard iterations, right? I can have original u0 and v0 prescribed by my initial data, and then I do Picard iteration, and if I prove that it is a Cauchy sequence, or in other way, it's a contractible map, then this sequence of function converge, and hopefully to the solution, right? So this is how we want to find solution to this thing. Now we also have to worry about integrability condition. But instead of equality of mixed partial, we now have this condition, or in other words, this condition. If they commute, right, this is kind of equality of mixed partials. I differentiate in G direction and I direction. But if they don't commute, I have this right non-zero right-hand side. And I do pretty much what I have shown you. I write it out, I substitute things from the equation. I want non-prescribed derivative of u alpha to be present here, and equality should hold as an identity. Okay, so maybe I'm going too fast. Maybe I have like, are there any questions actually? I kind of feel I'm like moving too fast. Maybe I'll pause again in some other place. And so this is how, if you carefully write it down, it's again like a lot of indices, but pretty much these are equations on F, on what stands, given functions which stays on the right. So we have no problem in writing integrability condition for this. And as I showed here, we can pretty much write a Picard iterations here and find a solution. That's what we saw. This was pretty much our idea, how we prove it, and we wrote out the proof. And then we found the gap. So we need, it turns out we cannot write, we cannot have, we cannot run this Picard iteration for all configurations of vector field and initial data. There is some, we can run into problems. So we need to introduce, and I will show an example of what's a stable configuration condition. To really run Picard iteration, we need some geometric condition on vector fields in the data. How do they interplay? We also realize that this is necessary and sufficient for the uniqueness. So at the beginning, we tried to prove this, to sort of close this gap, but we didn't know. Maybe it's just what is required to have proof. But then we found a counterexample and realized, no, they're necessary. Without this condition, we don't have uniqueness. And also, fortunately, which we were very happy to realize very quickly, that they're automatically satisfied by the original DARPU setting, so at least this argument direct proof worked for original setting. And we also realized that this table configuration condition have nothing to do with with the system being overdetermined, or with the fact that we're using vector fields instead of partial derivatives. It manifests itself in much more simple examples that we are considering. So let me talk, and so to demonstrate the stable configuration condition, we can consider a very simple system. It's this determined system of equation. I just differentiate u with respect to x and v with respect to y. And so now, because v is differentiated only with respect to y, I have more freedom in prescribing data. And I say, let's prescribe some data for V. And this is, but now I can prescribe it in one dimension. This is still X bar Y bar, as before, this I should not remove. This is actually, I will make colors which are similar to what will be. So this was blue, this is a data for U, just to match my, and this now could be a data for V. So that's the simplest case, right? But we don't want necessarily to prescribe our data along straight coordinate lines. So maybe we want to change. Maybe I want to prescribe, instead of doing this, I might say, no, I'd like to prescribe my data for U along something like this, and my data for V along something like that. Okay? As long as they're transversal, or I can say in non-characteristic curves, we should be fine. Or maybe not. So this is a standard case when you prescribe data like in my picture. And so what you do, if I want to find solution for U, I pick up a say what would be the value here, I pick up a data here, and I integrate the right-hand side of the equation along this line, similar for V, and nothing bad happens. But now I do a little bit. The only thing I changed, I even did not introduce curves, I just sort of tilted the lines. So here I tilt a little bit, right? This was originally y-axis, now it's a little bit tilted here, this is a little bit raised here, or I tilt them a lot, right? Now sort of red and blue changed their position. And the situation is changing dramatically because here I still want to recover u, and I think I prescribe data, and everything is local, so I prescribe data not along entire lines, but in this subset, right? And here I can determine this rectangle where I can integrate without any problem. I always, for any point in this rectangle, I can find corresponding point here and just reach it, right? And here, just reach it from my data. But here, everything changed. I want to find here, right? I want to get my data here, but here I don't have any data, right? I get out of my region. And if you try to write, you can say, well, that's not a problem, just prolong it, just prescribe data everywhere. Well, then you stop to work locally, right? And if you try to write Picard iteration, you will come up with a problem anyway of needing to impose the data farther and farther away from the place you want to show the existence of the solution. So this is a very simple example of stable, non-stable configuration. So if you are in an unstable case, what we realized, so that if you start to do Picard iteration, then integral curves run out, curves along which you have to integrate run out of the domain of the definition of the iterates. That's what happens, so you cannot really write Picard iteration. And moreover, this is in our second paper, we realized that uniqueness fail in an incredibly strong sense. I will explain. There are different notions of non-uniqueness. So we consider a very simple system, ux is equal to v, vy is equal to u, which is equivalent to ux equal to u, which we then generalize to a more complicated equation, but that example illustrates a lot. And on your unstable configuration, you prescribe just zero data along. So you say u is zero along this blue line, and v is zero along this red, not line, I should say, segment, right? And of course, u and v identically zero, of course, will solve your equation with this data. But moreover, we were able to construct, or at least prove the existence, not explicitly construct, but prove the existence of the solution, which is non-zero on this wedge arbitrarily close to the origin. So you may say that first we found example at the beginning when we realized non-uniqueness. We just realized that I can always find two solutions which are different, but they may agree in at least in the neighborhood of the origin. But these two solutions, they are absolutely very strongly non-unique because the second solution is non-zero as close to the origin as you wish. Actually, it is non-zero everywhere inside this wedge. This is a very strong non-uniqueness. So if we would like now a generalized Darboux, corrected formulation, we have the system, we can prescribe our data along manifolds, which could be curved, they don't have to be affine subspaces, and they should be transversal to the derivatives, to the vector fields. We should have integrability condition, but we also want our configuration to satisfy this stable configuration condition. And the stable configuration condition in the small example which I showed, it's kind of easy to formulate. It is pretty much blue line should be above, not below the red line. But of course, if you consider a general setting, it's a little bit technical to formulate, but it can be written out. So what is the outline of the proof? So we do the following. We use Picard type argument, Picard iterations, to prove existence and uniqueness of the solution for the restricted system. So this system has the same equation and data of the original system, but each equation is required to hold only for x on a certain and general low-dimensional submanifold containing x. And this sounds like a lot of things. I would just maybe return back to that original example, like this. So we have this system of equation, right? And first we find a solution for which equation for you would be satisfied everywhere. The last equation for V would be also satisfied everywhere, but the first equation for V would be only satisfied along this sort of a more bold purple line. So the same system of equation, but we don't require it to hold everywhere. The first and the third hold everywhere, while the second holds only along this purple line. So is that what we do? Probably I should have. And then, so we show the existence of this equation. And then we do a trick, which is probably, I mean, it's often used. So what we introduce new variables, which is pretty much the difference between left and right-hand side of our equations with this solution of the restricted system substituted in. Because this is now a specific function, this is just a function of x, right? So if you, what we now want to prove that this is identically zero functions, right? If they're identically zero, then our u tilde satisfies our equations. Now we use integrability condition of the original system to show that functions ai alpha satisfy linear homogeneous system of equation of the restricted type described here. And because we proved uniqueness here, and because A is equal to zero is a solution, then we get a solution to our original, we get that U tilde, which we originally get as a solution of our restricted system, is a solution of the entire system. I have another slide about how we get this restricted system, but I now think it's kind of getting a bit technical. You can just see that we run sort of Picard-type iterations here, but I will skip that, and I will actually talk about, maybe for, I don't know, 10 minutes, which I have, about why did we start to study this problem, why we started to look at the integrability theorem of Darboux, unless there are questions, otherwise I'll go to motivation of the problem. So if not, I will go to the motivation of the problem. So what we did here, we studied what is called system of hyperbolic conservation laws. So U is here a vector of variable, capital U. And this is flux, right? If we integrate, we will see that derivative, that if you integrate with respect to x, you will see why it is called the conservation law, derivative of the integral of u with respect to t is equal to whatever flux prescribes you. Yeah, also. And in the study of this, we came up with a subproblem, which is called the Jacobian problem. And the Jacobian problem is very simple to formulate. You are on n dimensional space, and you give yourself n vector fields, which are independent at every point. And you are looking for F, this is a map from open subspace to Rn. So if you take a Jacobian of F, you get n by n matrix, right? This n by n matrix will have some eigenvectors. But in this case, it's not a constant matrix. It's a matrix full of functions, right? And so this would be not eigenvectors, but eigenvector fields, right? Because they vary from point to point. And what we're looking for the Jacobian, for F, for fluxes, such that our prescribed vectors are eigenvectors of this Jacobian. That's what we are looking for. Why we are interested in is that if you are given this system of equation and you want to construct its solutions, then eigenvector fields of the Jacobian play a big role in constructing of the solution of these systems. So our original motivation was in sort of back engineering. We say, let's take eigenvectors with certain properties and find conservative systems for which this eigenvector. So we were sort of looking like forward process. You have a system of conservation law, you will find these eigenvectors, eigenvector fields, and you construct the solution, you construct wave curves. But we wanted to go back. We want to construct system of conservation laws with the prescribed wave curves, right? So we are back engineering. And this is an example. So this is a one-dimensional compressible flow. So you have a gas which is compressible, which is maybe moving forward in a thin tube. And then you have like Euler system, and V is a volume per unit mass, so it's one of the density. This is one of the variables that, which pretty much describes the density of your gas. U is the velocity. S is entropy, which for me is a very difficult concept. I kind of always think if I talk about something, I should understand what it is. And I really hard to try to read on entropy. And I know that, for instance, it somehow measures like a degree of freedom of your system to be, and it also related to the temperature. But I cannot say I have a good grasp of what entropy in physics mean. In this situation, we want it to be constant, not change of time. I know that usually it increases, it cannot decrease, but that's what the system is. And so we have pressure, but pressure is given. Pressure is a given function. So V, U, and S are unknown, pressure is given. So this is an example of a system which I've been talking about. So we have U of T, V of T, S of T, and then the flux is, what is the flux? F is this, right? This is what is differentiated with respect to u in our equation, with respect to x in our equation, minus u, p, and here nothing, zero. So this is our flux. And then you find eigenvectors of flux. They would look like this. And of course, you have eigenvalues. And then you can use them to solve, to construct solution of the system. So this is usual approach. What we want to do is to say conversely, I have these vectors, I prescribe a function p, I take these vector fields, three vector fields, find all fluxes such this is my eigenvector fields of my Jacobian. Do we have only the one which prescribes other system of equation, or maybe we have more? And the answer for this question is the following. So this is given pressure function. If this derivative of non-zero, then pretty much we can recover only what this gas equation of one-dimensional flow of gas could tell us, because these parts is what we call trivial flux. For any, it's lambda times our variable, lambda is just a constant plus a constant vector. This would work in any situation. Why? Because any vector field is the if you try to think about it a little bit, any vector field is an eigen vector of the Jacobian of this matrix, because it's just lambda identity times lambda, right? If I take a Jacobian. So this is part is trivial. So essentially we say that there is only things which are prescribed by which are gas dynamics, which would be here. If this is zero, then we have tons of fluxes. It depends on three arbitrary functions and one variable. And I can show like more examples like this. And this is maybe not physical, but it sort of illustrates how non-trivial I think the question is. So we take three vector fields, and integral curves are lines, parabolas, and circles, not so bad. And the only fluxes are the trivial fluxes. So lambda times vector of your unknown plus constant. So with this, but if we change a bit, we have like hyperbolic spiral, so it would be the, so we still have circles and lines, but instead of parabolas, we now get these more complicated curves. Then we have something interesting. We have non-trivial flux. This is similar to what we get for earlier system. And of course, if you start to play with the things, we say, okay, why not to take like f our vector field, just coordinate vector fields. Then we get a lot of fluxes. This actually should be F, sorry, this is a misprint, capital F, right? Any flux like this would have this as your eigenvectors. So the answer varies a lot with the structure of the frame. And to study these questions, in the study of this question, in the study of in determining, because you can see that we would instead in recovering these fluxes and writing the equation for the fluxes, we started to write equations of what of PDEs. We wanted to determine the degree of freedom. We did not want to, in our first paper we used Cartan-Curler theorem, but we were not quite happy with this. We wanted did not want to be in an analytic category. We wanted to be in relax a little bit analyticity, and we also had feeling that we are trying to catch flies with a hammer, that Cartan-Curler is too big of machinery to handle what we're trying to handle. And so we were very happy when we discovered this Darboux theorem and realized that this is what we need to use for that purposes. And yeah, thank you.